Hey, welcome back to my channel. This is Meorah, and in this video, I'm giving you guys my 1 month update on how life has been like living in Israel since I made Aliyah. Okay, so let's start with how I'm feeling overall, my just overall reactions, initial impressions. And I will say I am just like glowing and delighted and just so thankful to be here. I truly still can't believe that I live here, and I'm not exaggerating when I say multiple times a day I will stop and thank Hashem that I actually live here. I literally start my day. I start my day with Moda Ani, but after that I'm really thanking Hashem, like, thank you for another day in Yerushalayim. I can't believe I'm here. And that's just the emotion I carry with me each and every day, even though I'm like a month into this whole experience. So I'm just feeling so incredible to be like in the actual land of Israel. I really came here without too many particular expectations, but to be honest, if anything, I had a bit of trepidation as to like whether I would feel comfortable and like feel like this is actually home. And I have to say, as soon as I came here, I really felt such a deep connection, such a bond to the land of Israel, and just knowing that this is like my place. So I'm really relieved that that's been my overall like feeling and emotion. And I think that's also helped me just have like just an open heart, open eyes, as I'm experiencing this like transition stage of getting acclimated to the community, to the environment, to the society, and all those different components of adjustment. And looking back, like, I almost moved to Sfat. Like, when I was thinking about different places to potentially move to, it was actually between Sfat and here in Yerushalayim. And I can't believe I almost moved there, because I've never even visited Sfat, but I just had this like very romanticized view of it. I still definitely want to visit there, and maybe I'll move there someday, but ultimately I'm so glad that I picked my location, because not only am I in Yerushalayim, but I'm like right in the center. So I'm in the middle of all the action. I just like, even just walking around and like taking like a 10-minute stroll, I hit so many awesome, exciting places. So I've been just really excited to be here each and every day. Now, in terms of any challenges I faced, I have to say I have been very lucky. They've been pretty minimal, like, if at all existing. I really don't think I've faced any challenges really coming here. And I owe so much of that to the whole system of how Olim are treated, I think. So I made Aliyah through Nefesh B'Nefesh, and I feel like I keep saying so many good things about them, because I'm honestly just floored by the whole organization, the whole program. You know, they really hold your hand through the process, and they, everything from the airport and just going through the actual process of Aliyah to post Aliyah, they have a whole post Aliyah department. And if you don't know how to do something, they have like an answers like hotline to either call or email, and those guys respond right away. So like just the other day, I was having a hard time figuring out like the menu options in English to make a dentist appointment, and I emailed them, they emailed me back right away. So everything like that is just like makes me feel really buffered and supported, just knowing that there's somebody in English that can always help me through some of the trickier aspects of getting through life in Israel. So that's been a huge support. And on top of that, there's actually a department, I don't know if every city has it, but here in Yerushalayim, there's a there's like an Aliyah integration department. I'm getting the name wrong, but basically there's somebody from the city that connects with you who is also an English speaker and helps you figure things out as well. So if I have a question about how to do anything, or, you know, just need some support, I can always reach out to their people. So that's been also huge, just like air of relief, just to know that those two support systems are there. So I haven't really felt like I'm stuck and really like necessarily challenged by anything. That being said, I will say, like, I think a lot of people are curious about whether or not you have to like know Hebrew, whether that's challenging, you know, as somebody whose primary language is English. I have to say that hasn't been much of a challenge, but it has been a little bit challenging. And just from like a gut check point, like point of view, I think that I feel like out of the people I've interacted with, maybe about 80%, maybe that's being generous, but it feels to me like 80% of the people speak English, and at least enough to communicate. And I'm saying that from the perspective of having basically just interactive people from like vendors and, you know, people who are working at places. But for the most part, I've been able to get by without much trouble. I basically know some broken phrases in Hebrew so far. I'm still trying to learn. I feel like I often say ani ola, or I tell them like ani lo mevina ivrit, which means I don't understand Hebrew yet. So I'm just kind of getting by with that a little bit for the most part. But yeah, I think most people speak English. It has been too hard. But I will say, like, my one, like, really probably my only challenging moment here so far was when I went to the bank. I've been going to different like offices, like to get my insurance card. I went to the hospital, going to different, like, you know, different departments that you need to go through the Aliyah process to get my passport, things like that. I've done different appointments, in other words. But when I went to the bank to open up a new account, I went to my local branch and I, you know, had to make an appointment a week in advance, got there right on time, and they give you a number. And usually at these sort of appointments, you know, they give you a number and they'll call out the number, but it also pops up on a screen. And in this particular bank, I didn't notice numbers popping up on the screen. So it's like, oh my gosh, I'm gonna have to know. I think my number was like 501, and I don't know how to say that in Hebrew. So I Google translated it. It doesn't have the vowels. I'm not totally sure how to pronounce it, how to listen for it. And long story short, I missed my number not once but twice, and then the banking associates seemed to be a little bit frustrated with me. They're like, you have to pay attention, and, like, you know, and they gave me a new number and they were a little bit like just annoyed with me. And this one particular banking associate, who was a nice man, like he was trying to be helpful and like he was, you know, being a helpful guy, but he just had that very Israeli energy in terms of being very forward and just a little bit aggressive, but like not aggressive in a mean way, but it felt like that to me at the moment because I was just already so flustered from having missed two of my numbers, the banking associates getting frustrated with me, and then this particular guy, and he's speaking to me in English, but he's like explaining, like, he's like, you have to pay attention. And like just the way his energy came off, like I think it all just came crashing down at me at that moment, and I just felt so helpless and I felt like a child, just like, you know, being in the situation where I just can't navigate something as simple as, make you know, like going to the bank, which I've done a million times as an adult. Just having that experience being such a, just, you know, I just felt so vulnerable. And no joke, I literally cried at the bank, which is so embarrassing. But, and I don't think the banking associates noticed because, like, you know, they're busy doing their thing. And I just kind of like kept dabbing my eyes. Like I was like biting the inside of my cheeks, like trying not to bawl. But like, it wasn't just that situation. I think it all just came crashing down on me at that moment of just how overwhelming the whole thing was. So I think it, all the shock just came out like all at once in that moment. And it was just triggered by that man's energy. And just like, I felt really bad, like I was causing them trouble or something, and, you know, it wasn't a big deal, but it felt like a big deal at the time. So it was just like an emotional experience. And then during the whole appointment, I'm just like sitting there, I'm signing papers that I don't know what they say, and I am like really like against, you know, like any kind of legal document. I'm always, you know, the type of person who will read the fine print, but in this case, and, you know, here you just can't do that, and you can't ask the people to help translate every document that you're signing in certain cases. You just kind of have to move things along. So I just felt so vulnerable and uncomfortable, and that was a very challenging moment. But honestly, it wasn't because of that particular incident, like moment itself. I think, like I said, it was just all of it just kind of hitting me at once, like that I'm such a fish out of water, and just that, just, you know, realization. So that was my big scary moment where I literally cried in public, and an old man next to me totally did notice me crying. So like, oh, that was a little bit embarrassing, but that's all right. You know, it's gonna happen. I'm glad I got it out of the way, and that it wasn't such a big deal. You know, at least it was more like in my head, but that was the biggest challenge I faced so far. Okay, now let's talk about favorite places. And I kind of touched on it a little bit earlier, but I have to say, just like walking around the center, like on Yafo Street, like I think Yafo Street is my favorite just because it's like where all the action is here. And there's so many different little shops and stores and restaurants and just things going on. That's like the main street here pretty much. And that's where the light rail is, or like buses, and there's a lot of public transportation, but there's just so many people out and about, and I just love it. and I love the people watching, I love the energy, and even on like a quiet, like the quietest time, there's still like tons of people out on the street. Like you nearly, unless you're out there in like the middle of the night, which I'm not, like you barely ever see it without like at least 20 people in your view, but usually it's like hundreds and hundreds of people. So it's just such an exciting place to me, and overall I just really like walking around. I've been walking so much every day, and I'm definitely getting way over 10,000 steps on my Fitbit. Sometimes I get to like 20,000 plus steps. So that's been awesome for me too, just walking around and exploring. But yeah, my favorite places are just like the common areas of just like walking around the streets. I am here in like the Nachlo, like Machane Yehuda Shuk, like area. So like that's a really cool place too. But to be honest, I don't actually love going into the Shuk because it is too crowded for me. Like you are like shoulder to shoulder with people and you're like inching your way through the Shuk. So like I don't really find that to be very pleasant of an atmosphere. It's a little bit much for me. And there's not really anywhere I go like within the actual Shuk, but I do love the street, like the outskirts, like the perimeter of the Shuk. I do love that little area. I have like a special place I go to for my pita, and you know, I kind of like have my little neighborhood spots now. So I do love those areas. Let's see what else. Other favorite places. I actually have discovered that I think so far out of the neighborhoods that I've visited, I think I like Baca a lot. And that's the German colony, and it's very known for being very like Americanized, not Americanized, but that there are a lot of Americans who live there. So maybe that's why I just feel like it's just like a more chill neighborhood. It feels a little bit more suburban, I guess, definitely compared to where I am, which is like definitely not suburban. But it just kind of has a more chill vibe. And sometimes I like to go to the Aroma Cafe there. There's a special produce like grocery store where I get my special Shemitah produce, my Otz Haaretz produce. So I have like my little spots there as well that I like to go to. And I haven't been to too many other neighborhoods, but I feel like I could totally see myself living in Baca. So it's kind of like become one of my favorite little spots as well. Now, related to my favorite spots is the best thing I've eaten. And I will start by saying I've been a bit limited because since I've been here, I've started a vegan dietary lifestyle. I'm not gonna say call it a vegan diet per se, because it's not like I'm just doing it like as a diet. I'm just kind of like, I don't know, I guess if I had to pick one reason as to why I'm doing it, it's really for energetic purposes. Just trying to protect my energy and just thinking about the source of just like having animal protein in my body, just kind of spiritual, metaphysical, energetic reasons, but I won't go into that right now. But suffices to say, it's been going very well, and I've been really, really happy with just the way I feel on this vegan diet. And I'm saying diet too because I'm by no means a vegan. I do have like leather bags, leather stuff, and I'm not really at that point yet, and that's not necessarily the intention behind the veganism thing. It's more of a dietary lifestyle choice. But anyway, that all being said, I've been a little bit limited, and there have been so many amazing things that I really want to try eating. Before this veganism thing, I was kosher pescatarian, so I would eat fish and I would eat a whole lot of dairy, which is another reason I want to try this vegan thing, because I eat way too much dairy. I love, love, love milk, and I love cheese, as most of us tend to love. But so anyway, there have been a lot of delicious things that I wish I could eat that I can't. Like, just right across the street from me is Marzipan Bakery, which is like totally well known for its really amazing buttery arugula, and it smells incredible. So I haven't been able to eat that. At some point I would like to try it, but at least for now I'm continuing on with this vegan streak. So anyway, that was like so long-winded, sorry about that. But the best thing I have eaten has been, no surprise, falafel. And not just any falafel, but falafel from Ma'oz. And my friend told me about this, and his sister also like vouched for it. So I had kind of heard about this place before, and when I went there, it was the first thing I ate out when I got here and I was out of quarantine. And oh my goodness, this is like top-notch falafel. It's like a 10 out of 10, A plus, perfect, perfect, perfect. Like, it's just the kind of food where it's like you literally wouldn't change anything about it. Like, every ingredient, everything is just so amazing. And I don't even know how many times I've been there. It's like an embarrassing amount, but I actually had to like cut myself off. I'm like, I'm eating this way too often. So I stopped eating it for a little bit, but I love it so much. And I did make the mistake of trying a different falafel spot once, just like, I was like, I'm not gonna be boring and just be like, I don't want to be a creature of habits. It's like, go to the other place, just try it. And it was nothing like my own. And I just like, why mess with success? So I'm probably just gonna keep going back there every time I eat falafel. But I get it in, I alternate between getting it in pita and laffa. And I had never had laffa before. And I think it's Iraqi, but it's like a thin, it's like a thinner pita. And it's basically more like a wrap, like a thin naan type of bread. And it's like chewy and soft, and it's just so, so good. But I've been obsessed. So I get my, whether it's in laffa or pita, I get it with like salad and pickles and like those Israeli pickles that I've kind of gotten used to now, and some eggplant. And then you have some fries in there and the hummus and harif and tahina. And it's just delicious. I love it so much. I'm like obsessed with it. So that's definitely the best thing I have eaten so far. And that's out of a very limited menu. Like, I haven't really been eating out much in general. So that is that. I'm sure that I'll discover way more delicious things. If you have any recommendations of vegan food to eat here in Jerusalem, please let me know in the comments. Like, I feel like I'm just, you know, there's not so much I'm eating. I did try vegan pizza for the first time, and the pizza part of it was good, but like, I definitely don't like vegan cheese. I thought it was really plasticky and weird, so it just wasn't for me. But anyway, let me know if you guys have any recommendations of spots to check out. Okay, so moving on, let's talk about my interactions with people and just kind of how that's been overall. And I think for me, one of the things to think about is just like the cultural aspect. Of course, we're in a totally different place. I am Korean American, so I'm coming from a very different energy, let's say, from Israeli people. So I think that's been something I've had to get used to. Like I mentioned in my crying at the bank little moment, I've had a little bit of a hard time adjusting to some of the more aggressive forward energy. And it's definitely something I knew about Israelis before I came here. So I kind of like prepared myself. I'm like, okay, I'm gonna have to get used to that and have to like know how to kind of gel with people here, which is just very different than back in the States. But overall, like, I feel like, you know, I don't want to generalize here, but at least from my experience, the people I've dealt with here, I feel like people energetically kind of come in two forms. There's that very forward friendly Israeli, and then there's a very forward aggressive friendly Israeli. So I feel like I've met a lot of people who are just forward and friendly and just so open, I think is the thing that comes to mind. Like, people are just very open and very willing to help, which has been really amazing. And overall, yeah, I just feel like people are super friendly here. And I come from Boston, so like, people aren't like known to be friendly over in kind of like the whole East Coast in general. But like in Boston, like, you know, you just kind of mind your own business. Like, you don't talk to people on the street and stuff. So I think people, even just like asking me questions or asking if I need any help if I'm in a store, because, you know, I look like the lost foreigner or whatever. You know, that's been really nice to just have people talk and interact and stuff. So I've really appreciated that. But like I said, some of the more aggressive forward stuff I've had to kind of get used to. And I think one of my biggest like adjustment challenges too, which I didn't mention before, was I feel like a little bit overwhelmed with people asking me constantly where I'm from. And I know this is kind of just like my own internal stuff that I need to work through, but it honestly makes me a little bit uncomfortable. Like, one, because it's often just like that, are you from China or Japan kind of thing. Yesterday, one guy actually asked me if I'm from Kazakhstan, which I thought was interesting. But anyway, you know, it's very rarely, are you from Korea? Like, maybe once in a blue moon, I'll get that. But if I'm out and about for a whole day, like between 1 to 3 times a day, people will ask me where I'm from. So that kind of like, sometimes if I, you know, they kind of catch me at the wrong time, like it'll kind of like hurt or like kind of put me in a certain mood where I feel like, man, like people are gonna ask me that probably for the rest of my life here because I look like a foreigner. So it's a little bit frustrating, and sometimes it gets a little bit, I don't know, like overwhelming to have people ask me that constantly, you know, just for me, like knowing that I'm now from here. So I think that's kind of been something tough to get through. And kind of, you know, like definitely related to that is that it's always men who are asking that. And honestly, kind of like, I'll just be honest, it gets annoying because it's sort of like often used as like this pickup line entry point to try to start talking to me. And I just feel like not only do I really hate pickup lines and just guys like trying to overtly flirt or talk to you and stuff, but it just bothers me when that like opening is like, where are you from? Like, are you Chinese? Like, and you know, guys will, you know, when I'm walking by them, they'll be like, oh, ni hao. And like, they'll say stuff like that, which is, you know, creepy and just don't like it. So that just the whole thing like together, it's just, it's taken a lot to get used to. And the reason I mentioned all this too is that, you know, it's very much cultural, I think, like definitely like in Boston, like, you know, with the exception of guys here and there, depending on what their cultural background is, people don't really hit on you like that or like try to talk to you and stuff. But I think Israeli guys are definitely a lot more forward, and it goes with like that open, friendly thing. So like, nothing against it. It's just something I'm not used to, or, you know, just don't really love so much. But yeah, that will take a little bit of adjustment. So that's kind of like part of how I've been interacting with people. Other than that, I really haven't met like people, like actually like spent time much talking with people and stuff. I did have like a pretty long conversation with one guy who started, so like his opening was like asking me about the coffee I was drinking, which at least that wasn't like a creepy, weird personal question. So I actually talked to one person on the street for a good amount of time. But other than that, yeah, I haven't really interacted too much. I did start a creative project, a personal project called Aniola. I'll drop the link if you guys are just interested in poking around and seeing what it is. But I'm basically, I was curious to meet other Olim and other female Olim, just to learn more about their stories and what inspired them to make Aliyah and come to Israel. So what I did is started a photography project based on that background. And so I have a few different interesting women that I'm going to be sitting down and interviewing and taking their photos. So I'm excited to actually meet some people who really fully live here. So that's coming up. And I'm sure that obviously as time goes by, I'll be able to, you know, kind of mix and mingle with more folks who live here and get a little bit more acclimated to being one of them. So that's about it. Those are kind of like the bigger points I want to share, and just give you a little bit of a glimpse of how I've been adjusting here in Israel. Overall, I'm ecstatic. I love it. I'm like, just like, it literally brings me to tears, like pretty much on a daily basis. I can't believe I live here. So if you are still over in diaspora land, like, come on over, start your application, make Aliyah. It is amazing. I did it by myself, and it's very much doable. It's very much doable. And it's just, it's where we belong. Like, I don't want to get all up on a soapbox here, but I have to say, like, the biggest thing, the biggest benefit, the biggest feeling I've had here is just feeling so spiritually aligned. And like, if I had to pick one word of my whole experience of making Aliyah, it would be alignment, because I truly, genuinely feel deep in my soul, deep in my body, just viscerally, like, I actually finally feel like I belong here. And that's without having even found a community already. So it's just an incredible experience. And I'm just like, I'm getting emotional even just thinking about that now. So I'll cut it off here. With that all being said, thanks for sticking with me, you guys. As always, I'll see you in the next one. Shalom Aleichem.